Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20. We're on commandment 9. Hold on, we're almost through. Commandment chapter number 9. This is the second to last installment of our Ten Commandments series. We've been walking through the law of God given to the people of Israel. So,
as we begin today, I want us to hear the words of the psalmist. In Psalm 119, he wrote, "The entirety of your word is truth. Each of your righteous judgments endures forever." The psalmist wrote these words as part of Psalm 119 in a long, complex Hebrew poem, the longest chapter in the entirety of the Bible. And it is devoted to this idea that God's word is good, that it is true. That God has revealed himself in his word, and his words are true. God always speaks truth. To put that another way, God never lies. God never lies. We as Christians are not to lie. If you haven't heard it said that, you know that, you've heard that. If you haven't, let me be the first to tell you, as Christians, we are not to lie. We're not to tell half-truth. We're not attempting to pass off an untruth or a half-truth as the whole truth. This is the opposite of what we're supposed to do, because it is the nature of God to tell the truth. Again, the Apostle Paul wrote this in Titus chapter 1. He said, "In hope of eternal life, that God, who cannot lie, promised before time began." God's word is always true. He tells the truth. Here in the Ten Commandments, the summary of God's law, God tells his people that he always tells the truth. He also tells his people that they, reflecting him, should not bear false witness against their neighbor. Once again, we also need to remember what Jesus said concerning the summary of these commandments. When someone asked him, "Jesus, what is the greatest commandment?" What did he say? He said, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind." And he said, "The second greatest commandment is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself." That was Jesus' summary of these Ten Commandments. They tell us how to love God and to love our neighbor. And that is no more true than in this commandment, not to bear false witness against our neighbor, not to lie. But as we prepare to dive in, let's once again go for the Lord in prayer, and then we'll read his word. Our Father and our God, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to be here today. Lord, for the opportunity to know that you are good, Lord, you have spoken clearly through your word. Father, today as we dive in and seek to understand what you have said and how to rightly apply that to our lives, Lord, I ask that as we read, you would open our eyes that we might see, and unstop our ears that we might hear, and soften our hearts that we might understand. Father, as we dive into your word, Lord, show us where we have erred. Show us where we need to change. Lord, help us to trust you more as a result of what we hear today. We pray this in Jesus' name, so we know you hear us. Amen. This is the word of the Lord from Exodus chapter 20 and verse 16. God's word says this: "Do not give false testimony against your neighbor." This is the word of the Lord. We thank God for it. Once again, we have one of these short, direct commandments. As we think about the entirety of what we've read in the Ten Commandments, we come to this section where it's short, specific, clear commands. But we need to ask ourselves, what is this command about? See, some of us might have the temptation, as the Pharisees did in Jesus' day, to just take the words of the command and follow it by the letter, but not fully comprehend the spirit of society in general functions. So also this commandment, I think, prohibits us, tells us we are not to lie, not to bear false testimony. That also includes withholding truth when we are asked. Some have tried to circumvent this law, this command, do not lie, by saying that I'm not lying, I'm just withholding the truth. I'm just not going to tell you what you have asked for. And when we are asked for information by someone who has the authority to know that information, and we willfully withhold it, we are also guilty of lying. Let me put it this way. When I was a child, the question would often be asked, Daniel, did you clean your room? And he would normally go, something that his mom would say, Daniel, did you pick up all the toys off the floor? And I would say, yes, I picked up all the toys off the floor. What I would help was that I'd take all the toys off the floor and put them onto my bed in a pile about to get high. But I wasn't lying, per se. I was withholding the truth and saying I clearly was not doing what my mother asked me to do. She intended for me to clean my room and put the toys away in their proper place. Instead, I circumvented that by doing something different. See, if someone who has the proper authority asks us for information and we willfully withhold it, we are also guilty of lying. This is not just when it comes to cleaning your room, but it might be at your workplace. It might be that when you make a mistake at work, you can easily lie and cover it up. You admit to your mistake. And then as you admit to that mistake and your coworker say, why did you just cover it up really quickly? You say, because I have been saved and my God expects me not to lie. But also, I think this command, not only is lying in legal context forbidden, not only is withholding truth forbidden, also lying in general. As we deduce what this command is about, it's really about telling the truth as a reflection of who God is. You see, we find that this command is really rooted in the nature of who our God is. The fact that we are made in the image of God means that we are to reflect Him to society. We are in God's image and we are to act how He acts. And God does not. Why? We're juxtaposed. God, who does not lie, juxtaposed to Satan, who Jesus himself calls the father of lies. But in particular, this command is concerned with our relationships with one another, with people. Not only do we lie, but do we lie about others? Are we honest in our dealings with other people? Do we speak truth about their personal lives, their work, their families? Or do we seek to lie to tear others down so that we might gain a customer or look better in front of our friends? Do we lie about other people's families and try to keep them keep them in or out of a certain place in our society? All of these things are lying and are unjust and forbidden by this. And these things also border on rumors and gossip that can also be lies. Rick Warren, a pastor in California, had a really good definition of gossip. He said this, when you're talking about a situation with somebody who is neither part of the problem nor the solution, you are probably gossiping. This goes for both things you are assured of and you know are true, but also things that are lies. We're to be people who tell the truth and speak honestly. But this is about relationships, you know. This is about how we interact with others. If you're talking to someone about a situation that you would be either part of the problem or the solution, it's probably a good time to stop that conversation. See, in this commandment, it's implied that we're to seek good of our neighbor. We're not to lie because it is a sin against God, but also because it is bad for put him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. The next day, he brought the man, or the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave it to the innkeeper and said, take care of him. When I come back, I'll reimburse you for whatever extra you spend. Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? The one who showed mercy to him, he said. Then Jesus told him, go and do the same. What does this have to do with the ninth commandment? The ninth commandment not only prohibits us from bearing false testimony against our neighbor, not to lie about someone who we know or are acquainted with, but we're also not to lie, bear false witness against anyone who we might come in contact with. Our neighbor is not just those who we know, but it is all people. People made in God's image. Telling the truth is one of the key ways that we love our neighbor. That's how Jesus described our proper obedience. We love our neighbors by speaking truth no matter what. We seek to be people who tell the truth. That's the best way that we can reflect God in our society. The best way we can be for our society. God has designed us to work and function when people tell the truth. Thus, for us to willfully lie is not only to disobey God, but it's also to be working against the good of our society as a whole. We're called to love our neighbor by telling the truth. Telling the truth is also vital for us as we seek to share the good news of Jesus with others. You see, if we're people who are known for telling half-truths or even lies, if we're known as someone whose words are not trustworthy, then how is it going to sound to share the good news of our Savior with others? They might think we're trying to debate and switch them or trick them into something. Telling the truth is a way to reflect God to our society, but it's also a way to advance the good news of the King. So how does this work out in our own lives? What application can we draw from this commandment? How does it change how we are to live? And I think for us, it comes back to the mission of our church. To the Ten Commandments teach us how to love God and how to love people. And the process by which we learn to love God, we grow in our love for Him, and we grow to love people and share the good news with them. This is what it means to make disciples. As we grow in the knowledge of God and His grace, we come to fulfill the mission that Christ has called us to be better followers of Jesus. We are not to lie. Part of loving God is seeking to obey His words. We seek to love Him by doing away with our sin. That is, by God's grace and for His glory, we seek to put away sin and trust in Jesus. This might mean that you need to confess your sin of lying to a person who you see. It might mean that you need to ask a fellow brother or sister in Christ to hold you accountable for what you say. Maybe you need to begin a habit of daily Bible reading and prayer so that you can be reminded of the truth of the gospel and be motivated to strive towards godliness and truth. We need to remember this is also a way that we love people. As we seek to be people who live in this way for the good of our friends and neighbors, we are to abhor lying. We need to seek to deal honestly with people. This is part of how we reflect Christ. Again, if you are known as someone who stretches the truth, then how is it going to come across when you seek to share the good news of Jesus with others? This seems to be the message that I hit week after week as we deal with these Ten Commandments. you don't